Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. In today's third installment about the underlying reasons and why women must be kept indoors, and if they go out, they must be covered from head to toes and nothing is to be seen out of them, as is being preached these days by the Salafi, Wahabi, Saudi school of thought and anyone who follows their school of thought. And obviously they say our Salaf, the predecessors, and they say it in such a way that it makes you believe that there is a unanimous agreement between every single scholar that has come from our time till that of Rasulullah ﷺ agrees on this, and actually it is not. And as I said it once, I saw a book written by someone 500 pages and over to prove that the niqab, covering of the face, is a must, is a compulsory act. What a bunch of nonsense. So here today I will tell you, it's because they look at a woman as the source of the fitna. They are the precursors to men. They are the ones that if women didn't exist in the street, according to them, there wouldn't be any fornication, there wouldn't be any zina. This is why they do everything they can to keep women indoors. And here is one of their chief arguments, that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was one day with his companions. And then what happened was, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered his home, and then he spent a little time, came out having had a shower. The Sahaba asked him, Ya Rasulullah, أَقَدْ كَانَ شَيْءٍ, has there something that happened? And it is said that Rasulullah ﷺ said, أجل, yes. And then he said, so and so passed by a woman, and that when he saw her, ﷺ, or what they claim he said, is that he saw her, and by seeing her, it aroused him. And so he went to some of his wives, and he slept with her. And then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَكَذَلِكَ فَافْعَلُوا, and you should do the same, فَإِنَّهُ مِنْ أَمَاثِلِ أَعْمَالِكُمْ إِتْيَانُ الْحَلَالِ, it is as the best exemplary of your good deeds is to sleep with your halal, women with their husbands and husbands with their wives. And this hadith is by Ahmed and At-Tabarani and Abu Naim in Al-Hilya. And this hadith has been authenticated, or at least the chain of narrators has been authenticated by Al-Albani. And he also says, alayhi rahmatullah, in his silsila, hadith 441, that وَرِجَالُهُ كُلُّهُمْ ثِقَاتٍ, all the men in this chain here are all reliable and trustworthy. إِسْنَادُهُ صَحِيحٌ وَرِجَالُهُ كُلُّهُمْ ثِقَاتٍ. This hadith in particular, the one that I just mentioned, was asked to Islam QA. And the person said, I am about to lose my religion for that Prophet ﷺ did these things here. And Sheikh al-Munajjid tried his very best to diffuse the tension. He even accused that the chain of narrators that al-Albani claimed that it is authentic, it is not authentic. And he said the hadith is weak and whatever he said. Well, al-Albani is always of the opinion that it is an authentic chain of narrators and all the men are reliable. And this is a very dangerous game the Salafi play. When a hadith fits them, and al-Albani authenticates, and al-Albani is the only one scholar in the whole history of that hadith that says authentic, while all the other scholars say it's weak, they will tell you al-Albani authenticated it, and that's that. It becomes an evidence. But when a hadith is against them, and al-Albani authenticates it, they will tell you, no, al-Albani is well known that when he authenticates his hadith, he is not as reliable as when he weakens a hadith. And this is just the game they have always been playing. But anyway, in Jabir, it sheds more lights. In hadith of Muslim, it sheds more lights. And that is that Jabir says that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw a woman. And then he went to his wife, Zainab, and she was tanning a leather. So she was busy, the poor lady, working at home. So what he did is, he asked her to come here. And he slept with her. And then he came out to his companions, with his ghusl and everything. And he said these very dangerous man-made words. Rasulullah ﷺ would never utter such nonsense. They said, he said, that the woman advances and retires in the image of a devil, shaitan. So when one of you sees a woman, he should come to his wife, for that will repel what he feels in his heart. And this is in Muslim. So to every Salafi scholar or anyone who believes in Muslim and all this kind of hadith, to him, a woman is, when she is out, she is in the image of shaitan. And when she retracts back home, she is in the image of a shaitan. This is why a woman to the Muslim community is a problem. She is not a solution. Don't believe the nonsense, you know, when they put, oh, the woman, the wife, Islam honored women, all these are contradictory statements. And for your information, the number of people leaving Islam is unbelievable, and I am not talking in the West, I'm talking in the Arab world. Let us ask the multi-million dollar question to follow. How was that woman dressed to arouse a man who is in total control of his desires? And why do I say he's in total control of his desires? It's because when our mother Aisha, as in al-Bukhari and Muslim and everything, when she was asked about Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, would he cuddle up to his wife when he was fasting? She said, Na'am, yes he would. But he had the greatest control over his desires amongst you. Or he was one of those who had the great control of his desires. And this is in Ramadan fasting. So, if this man had the great control over his own desires, how was this woman that Rasulullah saw? And she threw him into a frenzy that he couldn't hold himself. How did she walk? Was she totally perfumed? And why did she just affect him? You see, the insults that Banu Umayyah have put amongst Rasulullah ﷺ are as such that he was amongst his friends. So nobody was affected by this woman, or by this woman, except Rasulullah. And most importantly, how long did the Prophet ﷺ spend looking at her till he got aroused? We men, we know, we see a lot of women in this street. They dress sometimes unbelievably almost naked. And guess what? Like a glance of an eye and we turn and we go on about our lives and nothing happens. So you have to really pay attention to that woman. Keep looking at her until your mind realizes and takes that information and turns it into desire. So how long has Rasulullah been looking to this woman, such big, huge lie? Would he be them? And again, would Rasulullah be the man who taught us not to passionately look at a woman and not to passionately look at a man? Isn't he the one who said to Ali, the first one is for you, the second is against you? And how long was that first one? You see the accusations made to Rasulullah ﷺ, and I will tell you why. Because they wanted to put the woman inside the door, inside the home. They created these ahadith and they linked them to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is why when a man came to Rasulullah ﷺ asking him, Ya Rasulullah, ayu jami'u ahlahu thumma yuksil. I.e. a man sleeps with his woman, but there is no orgasms in that. So what happens is, do they have a ghusl? And they say, Aisha was sitting. So the man asked Rasulullah ﷺ about this sexual question while our mother Aisha was sitting with Rasulullah ﷺ. And Rasulullah ﷺ said, إِنِّي لَأَفْعَلُ ذَلِكَ أَنَا وَهَذِي ثُمَّ نَغْتَسِلْ. And they claim that Rasulullah ﷺ said to this man that I and this one, pointing to Aisha, we do it. And then we would take a bath. And this hadith again is in Muslim. Would you answer someone, a foreigner, when your wife is sitting in front of you with such nonsense things? And listen to what Al-Bukhari and Muslim and countless of other books of hadith describe Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu says, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أشد حياء من العذراء في خذرها. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم was more shyer. He had more shyness in him than a veiled virgin girl who has never been approached by a man. So that shyness is صلى الله عليه وسلم. And Nawawi says, and the translation is from me, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم wouldn't say something that he dislikes because of his shyness. In fact, his face would turn and change color, and that's how the companions knew what he disliked. And then he said, shyness is very good as long as it doesn't lead to weakness. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would use his wife and he would say this, yeah, we do this, and he wouldn't be shy. Take any regular nonsense sheikh of today, those government employed people. or university must produce sheikhs. Would they say such a thing to another man using their wives as an example? Knowing that the Arabs are really, really, really and a thousand really hang up when it comes to sexuality, and they have more taboos than elephants have about mice. SubhanAllah, this is why women must be kept minimally indoors, is because they want to avoid all this shame and all this, walayyadu billah, hatred and all these things. Wallahi al-Azim, they are really, really, really women haters, these people. Aisha radiallahu anha says, جاءت امرأة إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم تسأل عن الغسل من المحيض. A woman came to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم asking him about how to purify, clean himself when she has her menses. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم just nicely explains, I just go to the translation here, he just take your water and purify yourself as best as possible. Keep it simple. The lady said, how do I do that? And Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Subhanallah, Subhanallah. And what he did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he felt very shy. And then he covered his head with his garment because of the shyness that he went through. And this narration is in Abi Dawood. And the hadith is in Al-Bukhari, Muslim, in all the books of hadith. This is the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we love. Not the one who sees a woman and goes, he can't hold his desires and things like that. All these ahadiths have been invented so that women are kept indoors as much as they live. And if a woman says, why can't I go out? They will say, well, you actually cause a sexual problem to Rasulullah. And you come out in the image of shaitan and you go home in the image of shaitan. This is why you must be kept at home. And this is absolutely, Rasulullah is utterly innocent of this, even if it is Al-Bukhari and in Muslim. Look also on how what they use to keep women indoors so that they can't do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them for, and that is being positive player in the community where they live. They always mention the hadith reported in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, مَا تَرَكْتُ بَعْدِي فِتْنَةً أَضَرَّ عَلَى الرِّجَالِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ, which translates, I have not left after me any turmoil more injurious, more hurtful, more harming to man than the harm done to the man because of women. So, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam here says it, that man without women would be a much better state. That man without women will go easily to paradise. The reason why the biggest tribulation ever to hit man that will hinder them from going to paradise is, guess what? The presence of women. This is why further on, it is reported in hadith by Ahmad, Tirmidhi, and Nasa'i, and Ibn Hibban, and the hadith is authentic. They say that, they say, because I don't believe Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم says it, لا يخلون رجل بإمرأة إلا كان ثالثهما الشيطان. When a man is alone with a woman, their third is a shaitan. This is why one day a sister told me in one of my talks, she said, when I was student at the university, she goes, whenever a Salafi brother, and there were lots of them, whenever he comes in the room and he finds a sister or something, he would always say, A'udhu billahi min shaitan ar-rajim. Why? Because when he saw the woman to him, what? She is the image of shaitan. She is actually a tool of a shaitan. If he is with her alone, the third is a shaitan. Now let me tell you why this is a nonsense lie that they put on the account of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, even if it is reported by Ahmad, al-Tirmidhi, al-Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, Hibban, and they claim that the hadith is authentic. Look first to what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says in Al-Quran. أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Don't you know, don't you see, don't you comprehend, don't you understand that Allah knows whatever is in the heavens and whatever is on the earth? Of course, yes. And then he says, مَا يَكُونُ مِن نَجْوَى ثَلَاثَةٍ إِلَّا هُوَ رَابِعُهُمْ. If three converse privately or privately, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is their fourth. ولا خمسة إلا هو سادسهم, and not five except that he is their sixth, and lesser than that or more, i.e. if two people are conversing with each other, the third is Allah. If three people are in private with each other, the third is Allah. If a person by themselves is alone, the second is Allah. Allah is with us, and this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا أَدْنَى مِنْ ذَلِكَ وَلَا أَكْثَرَ إِلَّا هُوَ مَعَهُمْ أَيْنَمَا كَانُوا. Allah is with us wherever we may be. The hadith says, when two people are together, man and woman, the third is a shaitan. The Quran says, when a man and a woman are together privately, the third is Allah. So who do I believe? The hadith or Al-Quran? Every Muslim out there will tell you it's the Quran. But when it comes to the practice, it certainly is the hadith. Why don't we make people love Allah and fear Allah? And then when a man and a woman are alone and about to do something haram, then they will fear Allah, not blame a shaitan for whatever they do or put it on his tag bill. Now, the problem is really, really very dangerous. Then Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says that the true enemy of us are not women. The most mischievous and injurious and harmful creature to man, i.e. man and women, is not the female gender. It is a shaitan, as Allah has mentioned this countless times in Al-Quran. I will just mention one ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌّ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًّا. الشيطان is certainly to you a dedicated enemy, so undertake him as a fierce, clear, dedicated enemy, because his purpose is إِنَّمَا يَدْرُ حِزْبَهُ لِيَكُونُوا مِنْ أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. It is because he calls his own party, those who follow him, so that they be part of a sa'ir, that is hellfire, in the day of judgment. This is the continuous, total enemy. It is impossible that Rasulullah, who reads Al-Quran, would say that women are the most dangerous creature when Al-Quran says it is a shaitan. It is I, Abdus Salam. One compares my knowledge to the knowledge of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I am just like the drop of a bird in an open ocean, nothing at all. And if I could understand this from Al-Quran, it is impossible that Rasulullah would say something that is totally against Al-Quran. When two people are together, two men are together, two women are together, man and woman are together, the third is Allah. Subhanallah. Now let me tell you something, my dear sisters and my brothers. If we wanted to introduce Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam these days to people, to the non-Muslims, okay, to people who wanna, hey, someone comes to you and says, you know what, I've heard a lot about Islam, tell me about this messenger of yours, Muhammad, tell me about him, who is he? Now, we can choose to tell them about what the Quran says, or we can choose to tell them about what the hadith says. We will tell them what the Quran says first. Al-Quran says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. So his moral, his behavior, his attitude, his characteristics, his everything about him, you can put any superlative, beautifying adjectives. He is the most, the greatest, the wonderfulest, the toppest, the awesomest, any word you can put before his attitude. He has the biggest, the greatest, the most beautiful, the wonderfulest, the totest, the awesomest, the everything, morals, behavior. You cannot compare him to any other human, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. He is a mercy to all creation, not only to mankind. And رَؤُوفٌ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mercy in his heart for all the believers, and. There is no amount of great words that will describe his being sallallahu alayhi. Yet in our books of the hadith, and now we are going to tell these people that are curious about Islam who Muhammad is, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We'll start by telling them the messenger of Islam, the last of the prophets, the one who brought the beautiful Islam, was suicidal. He wanted to commit suicide, as in Bukhari. He was totally broke for 3 months, no food at home at all. And this is absolutely nonsense. He is unashamed to share his private sexual life with anyone who asks him. But in other hadiths, he forbids anyone to share with the other people. In other hadith we say, إِنَّهُ لَا يَرْضَ الْخَبَثُ, the evil thing that no one will enter Jannah, anyone who is happy with sexual things about his family. But he comes and talks to his people about his sexual life, about his wife, and that's fine to them. To us, it's fine. He died indebted to a Jewish man. When there are authentic hadith that Rasulullah ﷺ says, when a shaheed, a martyr, dies, all his sins will be forgiven except his loan, the debt. But our Prophet died indebted, it's okay. So we're going to tell this person, he was suicidal, he was totally broke, he was unashamed to share his private sexual life, he died indebted to a Jewish man, he was reprimanded by some of his followers, he was called the blooded and brutal murderer, he was a curser, he was an insulter, he was very judgmental, he wears women clothes as in a Muslim, he was contradictory in his statements, he was a hate monger, a babbler when he's sick, he doesn't know what he says, as Umar ibn Khattab says in Bukhari and all this, he was bewitched for 6 months till he couldn't say if he did something or not, especially sexual intercourse with his wives. He wouldn't know if he slept with his wife. He didn't. Should he require ghusl? He wouldn't. He forgets his Quran. One day he was walking until someone recited some Quran. He goes, oh, XYZ has reminded me of the Quran and I have forgotten this ayah. He talks about people on their back. He backbites. He sleeps through the whole night and doesn't wake up for salat. He enters the houses of married women when their husbands are away. He would put his head on their thighs and they would clear his head. As in Muslim, I read it's appalling this thing here. The Jewish women educate and teach him a part of the religion he didn't know about Islam. So this is the man that Allah sent and this is the man that Allah perfected. Everything that I mentioned that is horrible about our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam exists in the books of hadith, namely and Bukhari and Muslim, and the majority of them are in al-Bukhari and Muslim. Now my sisters, you understand why women might stay at home, because they are the source of evil. If the Messenger of Allah couldn't resist his sexual urges, so we are doomed. And this is why women are the way they are in Saudi Arabia. And the sad news is, those Saudis, they exported their sick mentality to the world and they labeled it and they canned it. They put it in cans and on the cans they put a label called the Salaf. This is the Salafi. This is what Rasulullah ﷺ was, and they lie. They are huge, big liars. Now you understand why there is such a huge problem in the Muslim community, not in Islam, because what represents al-Islam is the Quran, not the Hadith. I will say it again, what represents al-Islam is al-Quran, not the Hadith. And when we go to the Hadith, we take those Hadiths that work with al-Quran. My sister, they look at you as a source of hate, problems. You are the source of all problems that the male gender is experiencing. And as I said before, as in Sahih al-Bukhari, they say that Rasulullah ﷺ says, لَوْلَ حَوَّى مَا خَانَتْ أُنْثَ زَوْجَى. Were it not because of Hawa, suddenly Rasulullah ﷺ has named this woman when Allah hasn't named her. And he said, were it not for the wife of Adam, no woman would have betrayed her husband. A problem today is they look at you as the source of misery of the male. Now, would you believe that Rasulullah ﷺ is this horrible man? I'm going to ask like a little kid. Latifa, do you think Rasulullah ﷺ is this evil man who wanted to commit himself suicide?
No.
So, would you believe that Islam speaks this evil about women?
No.
So, my dear sisters, you really, really have to understand one thing. We have got to fight these things. Stop the... you see, the time of... we have to take everything from Bukhari and Muslim or any other book of hadith. Unquestionably, we don't ask questions, has gone past. And the biggest lie that is being promoted today is this. That Al-Bukhari is the most authentic book after the book of Allah. Now let me put it in retrospect. Let me put it like differently and see how evil this statement is. Allah is powerful. Now we're gonna bring the most powerful man on earth. Those guys that drive cars and trains and all these things, right? And we are going to say, when we give him the Guinness World Record, we're gonna say, this man is the strongest man after Allah. Would you take that? Now, we're going to bring the wisest man, and we're going to say to the people, this man is the wisest man after Allah, is the strongest man after the strength of Allah, is the wisest man after the wisdom of Allah, is the most merciful person after the mercy of Allah. Can we compare a God, a divinity, to a human being, a mortal? And it is well known in Al-Bukhari that he has done a lot of evil in his book. And inshallah, in due time, I will tell you what those things, because the time to wake up is now. My dear sisters and my brothers, we have to start the retaliation. We have to start the fight that Al-Islam came to honor women. Enough lies. There is no need to go to the Christian people, to the world, and we say the right of women in Islam and what Islam has given to women, only to come here and we find the Muslim community belittling, putting corner in, and really doing the best at making women feel their worst. So we really need to work on this one here. So by doing that, please help people become more savvy, more understanding that Allah gives a woman the same responsibility as that of a man. She is responsible over her genitals, just like a man is responsible over his genitals. She is responsible over her persona, just like the man is responsible. And on the day of judgment, only Allah will judge us. We cannot put someone in jail because we want him to enter Jannah. So we're gonna take someone, and let's say you have a child and you love your child, your unique child, so that you don't be unjust towards the others. But say you have one child and you want him to go to Jannah. So what you do, you take this child and you put him in a cell in a jail, and you nourish him well, and you make sure nothing of evil gets to him. And when he asks, why don't you let me out into this life? Now, why don't you let me live my life? You go, well, I'm doing that for your own good, because I don't want you to commit sins, and I want you to go to Jannah. This is what the Muslims, the Salafi Muslims and the Wahhabi and the Saudi and anyone who follows their trade are doing. They want to put women, if they could, in prison and jail, all women in a cell, and the only job of a woman is to produce babies, they would. Alhamdulillah, they couldn't do that. I pray to Allah, the third reason is clear now as to why they do what they do. If a woman has put Rasulullah through thick and thin sexually, who are we to avoid her mischief? And obviously, all this is nonsense, wrong, and absolutely horrible to put that on the account of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. If you want to join my group, please do send me a message on my WhatsApp group on 0787640 8735. Please do spread this video and let people become more aware. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. This talk also is on my YouTube channel, Islam Pep Talk. So go there and you find over 180 talks there that will help you, inshallah, make responsible decisions and understand Islam and enjoy it better. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.